Hello, guys. We back at the Deep Surface Podcast. How you doing today, fellas?
Good.
Man, listen, man, I'm happy to be here today, man. We got some news today. We was just talking about, we ain't going to spend a lot of time on this today, but some breaking news in the NBA right now. James Harden to the Philadelphia 76ers. Ben Simmons to the Nets. Mm. I think if you've been following the game over the last couple of months, via Ben Simmons, let's start there, you'll see that this was headed in this direction. And we was talking off camera a little bit about what happened to Ben Simmons, D. Whether he was faking or not, I don't know his motives, but I'm just going to go off what he's saying. And I see how he can arrive at that conclusion. Yes, he did went out of Philadelphia, but I think two things can be true. But this is a mental health issue, because think about it. Ben Simmons, number one pick in the draft. In 2019, they were a bounce away from going to the finals.
Yep.
And if all stays the same in the world of Golden State and everybody gets hurt, effectively, they win the championship. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So life changes. But what happens is Kawhi made the shot. Ben Simmons struggled to shoot the ball in late game situations. The infamous Trae Young last year in the playoffs against the Hawks. He was right there for a layup, and he threw it. But previous to that, he threw it away. Well, he passed it to his teammate. But previous to that, though, Keegan, people have been hounding him about shooting the ball. You can't shoot. You can't shoot. You can't shoot. Ignoring the fact that he's the best perimeter player in the league. Ignoring the fact that he's a walking triple-double. But we ignoring all of that. And the Philadelphia 76ers have been formidable. They have been a good team. Right. Everybody can't win the championship.
Only one can.
Only one team. But he's been great. But people hounding him on the internet, then it seeped into his teammates. It got to him. He was bullied. You can say what you want to say, but he was. And it drove that man, that talent, and people put all this pressure on him, D, to go. Is that a microcosm of what we do to people in society?
Absolutely. You know, that's what's happening all the way around. When, you know, but in the public eye especially, and then sometimes even privately, you know, we make our lives or whatever we're dealing with public, and we open it up to unwanted, unsolicited criticism.
That's good.
That's not intentional. But if you open up, you know, what's going on in your life to 500 followers, 5,000 followers, 500,000 followers, you have some people behind the scenes that are not fans of yours, you know, and they, you would think they were getting paid for the critique that they offer. You know, yeah. You know, it's like, it doesn't matter anything. Somebody's going to have not just an opinion. That used to be what we say, everyone has an opinion. But now, you know, everyone is targeting you. And so what happened with Ben Simmons, you know, we could have called that a slump. We could have.
Absolutely.
But then the media gets hold of it, because now you got, you know, male sports talk shows now that are like The View and Oprah used to be.
They are.
You know, where they literally are creating topics every morning. They are. Talk about, so they create, what if, how about, you know, and all of a sudden a professional athlete that may be slumping. First of all, he's never known as a pure shooter. Let's start there.
No, absolutely.
Then, that's a fact. You know, let's just give him, you know, reasonable NBA credit. He goes through a slump, but then people take advantage, you know, to take that topic, and all of a sudden, you know, no, he can't shoot. Well, that wasn't the case when he was number one draft pick.
Right. Facts, because they knew he that information
well
then.
Yeah, he shot well enough. So I think that's definitely what, you know, it's just an indication of what's happening in our society at large. And, I mean, it can be devastating, because I think it almost took Ben Simmons out, but I think he probably went behind the scenes, collected himself, and said, just get me out of here. And if I get a fresh start, now we can see. You
know. And Keegan, that's why narratives are dangerous. That's why painting narratives of people are dangerous. Because Ben, like he talked about, Ben Simmons coming out, the number one pick, he had confidence. But now the media starts saying, can he shoot? They talking about it every single morning. He sees that stuff. Then the fans start getting involved. Then Twitter starts getting involved. And then all of a sudden, you trying to block it out, but is there? There's no way in society. Sometimes we can block it out, and you got to hear. But how does?
Not when you're that young.
Yeah, when you're that. Yeah, he grew up in social media. You know, but no excuse for his behavior. I'm not making excuses for his behavior and how he went about doing things. But I do understand, Keegan, the mental aspect of it.
Well, there is a mental aspect to everything that we do in sports. But there's many rewards to being an athlete, a professional athlete. Money, fame. One of the rewards being a professional athlete is scrutiny. Plain and simple. Mm-hmm. I don't care what sport it is. And so you have to be able to absorb it, digest it, because to D's point, he wasn't picked number one because he had a 3-point shot. He was not picked because of the mid-range game. That was never his game. He was picked because he was a 6'9", 6'10", 6'11", triple-double waiting to happen, elite defender on the perimeter, and can run an actual manager team on the floor. So I think when somebody starts telling you you can't shoot, that's like telling Scottie Pippen he couldn't shoot.
Right.
Does Scottie care? He still got you 20-something points, 10 rebounds, 11 assists when he wanted to. He still defended the best player on the floor. He didn't care what you said. So I think there is a little bit of fragility with the youth. So I don't really co-sign the
bullying. By way of exposure.
But I don't co-sign the bullying thing because you sign up for that whenever you get in front of a camera.
Yeah.
I don't care if it's sports, media, acting. You sign up for scrutiny when you get in front of a camera.
Yeah.
But now, everyone's different, Steve. I want to be clear. Some people can't handle it. I get that. But that's part of the
actual. How do we measure scrutiny? I can do scrutiny. Scrutiny is something I get. But this went beyond. Because this man literally could not shoot. He's 6'10". Trae Young is 5'10". All you had to do was shoot the ball. It was a mental block. I'm not blaming anybody. He is paid well. Make no mistake about it. He's a superstar. He's expected to perform. Mm-hmm. No, I'm not taking him off the hook for that. But nevertheless, there's still something mental there. I'm not saying it's full on like a mental health, but there's something. There was a block that happened, Ivan.
I agree to a certain extent that there was a block. However, I also side with Keegan. You know, people, when you step out of what's considered to be reality into a super reality, there is an expectation of you. And fame comes along with that. And with that fame comes along scrutiny. Mm. You're not going. And so the thing is, we see it happening right now. Russell Westbrook is getting a lot of scrutiny right now.
Absolutely. Deserved.
Absolutely deserved scrutiny. However, we haven't seen it translate into a better game yet. So is it a mental block, or is he just not prepared to do what it is that he needs to do for his team?
I think it's absolutely a mental block with Russell Westbrook right now.
Could I ask a question, though? But it doesn't seem to be affecting Russell the same way it affected Benson. But I got a question for you. Many folks said Shaquille O'Neal couldn't shoot free throws.
Absolutely.
They created a whole strategy in the fourth quarter called Hack-a-Shaq. What did he do? He took it behind down the post. And still got 25, 30 points a game.
Every time.
He didn't. At some point, somebody got to understand who you are and believe that's right, what you are good at and do that and stay in that particular lane. Like I said, some people are a little bit more fragile than others. I have to respect a mental health issue from that perspective. But I'm not going to penalize society for scrutinizing him when that is part of the package of being a professional athlete.
Absolutely.
I think that's good.
Yeah.
But that doesn't, having an issue with your mental doesn't criticize them either.
I'm not saying he doesn't. Yeah. I'm not going to say he doesn't have one.
If you ever played sports, it's a block. Like if you won't even, like Westbrook won't shoot the ball. The crowd is yelling at him. Every morning they got a look on Skip and Shannon. They do a little. They do a little blooper tape for him. You know what I mean? Like, they're making fun of this man.
Steve, not every great star can operate in the big market.
You think that's the case for Westbrook?
I think the lights are too bright in LA for him. Yeah. I really believe that.
It exposes a lot of flaws.
I really believe that.
Because he's been doing his whole career.
Yes. This is nothing new.
He's always had, to me, I don't think he has a high offensive awareness. I think when he gets in a zone, he's in a zone. Mm-hmm. But his offensive awareness has always been shaky at best.
Yes.
You know, I mean, shooting off the top of the backboard is definitely not something new. It's not something new. We've seen this before.
So, like, before we leave off the sports, who won the trade, Scott? Did Philly win the trade, or did the Nets win the trade? You can answer that question too.
I feel like Philly won the trade.
Put a mic close for you.
I feel like Philly won that trade.
Ooh. Do tell.
Well, I'm sorry. Let me take that back. I'm sorry. The Nets won that trade.
Okay.
You're all right. My bad. That's my fault.
Okay.
That was verbal.
Yeah, because I was like,
you real debate. Good TV. Real debate. Yeah. I'm here to go down a rabbit hole. I wasn't going to be
able to. I was going to let you do it too.
Yep. No.
Yeah, go on down now, my boy.
We're friends like Steve.
They definitely, the Nets definitely got the best end of the stick on that, for sure. Without a shadow of a doubt. When you look at Harden's performance, ouch. But I will say this. The scrutiny that a lot of players are receiving right now for their gameplay, a lot of the times isn't warranted, because you always have to keep a certain few things in perspective. One of those being is that they're playing in a league of elite players. I actually had a conversation with a pro athlete once, and one of the things that he said to me is, you got to understand that it's hard to stop an elite scorer.
Absolutely.
If you're an elite scorer, you're in the league because you're an elite scorer.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
If you're an elite ball handler, you're in the league because you're an elite ball handler. Not for your scoring ability, but your ability to distribute the ball and run the team. Now, there are some athletes that possess the ability to be elite in more than one area. But when they draft you, they already had an idea of what they wanted from you from the time that you were drafted. With Ben Simmons, they knew what they wanted from him from the time he was drafted. Yeah. And like Keegan said, it wasn't to shoot the ball.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we already know that if he was to add that aspect to his game,
absolutely,
that it would take his star power much further.
Mm-hmm.
But not everybody has that capacity to grow in an area that they've never had to grow from. On an elite level, not that's just good. Your basic
like
level.
That.
Because if you put him in anybody else's gym,
he can
the NBA, he's going to eat your lunch.
Him shooting the ball.
But yes. And I will also say, too, it's a team sport. Mm-hmm. It's easy to target Ben Simmons because he didn't shoot the ball. Mm-hmm. But no one talks about Tobias Harris, who underperformed. Who underperformed, and he's talented.
And he got a max deal.
He's talented.
Man, listen.
And underperformed in a rate that I can't even comprehend.
Absolutely.
But you can target Ben Simmons. So that's where I think you have to have some context, in my opinion, to your point about you're drafted for a reason. They knew what they had to Ben. That's what I'm saying. You have to block out the outside noise. Because the reality is, to D's point, people think they get paid to criticize. You ain't ever played professional,
nothing,
collegiate, not even high school,
right? Sports. Nothing,
but you got an opinion.
Right. Okay, came off the bench,
sat on the sideline,
okay,
the whole,
yeah,
life.
Okay, and I think the frustration with athletes is when you let those opinions affect you,
yeah,
knowing that they've never done it,
yeah, absolutely,
and that's the confusion. Like, I'm letting this guy who's never been in my shoes affect my ability to perform.
Yeah.
That's frustrating.
Against other elite players at that.
No question.
Absolutely.
You're playing with elite as an elite offensive player. You're going to play against elite defenders.
Yeah.
They're not in the league because they play defense on a high school level.
Yeah.
Right.
They play defense on a level that will literally shut you down to the point that where you can't even catch the ball.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard for you to get open to even catch a pass, let alone get a shot off and make it.
True.
So, to comprehend what these players are dealing with on a daily basis when they step on the court, to be able to face that level of criticism every single day, I don't think he has a mental block. I think that he's faced with a lull in his game right now that will return.
Yeah. I think that's what a mental block, I think, is. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think he just mentally,
absolutely,
it just messing with him. It ain't nothing physical. That's why I said it's mental.
Yeah.
Because physically, he's performing. He's elite at what he does.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's a physical thing, which is why I said it's just a block, and you can remove a block.
Mm-hmm.
But something I want to add about James Harden, and I think that we missed this. In 2011, he was sent to the bench because D-Wade put him in the post. He had a turnaround jump shot on him, and he put him on the bench in the second quarter. And the Miami Heat went on to win that championship in 5 games. He's never learned how to define his role on a team with 2 other superstars. Mm. When he played with Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook back in OKC, he couldn't define his role.
It was defined form.
If LeBron wasn't hungry for that championship, OKC would have won.
It was 5 games.
No, but I'm saying that's why I said LeBron was hungry that year. That was after the 2011 debacle.
Oh, you mean averaged 14 points? 14
points. We ain't. This ain't no LeBron basketball.
You can go all the way there.
We're not doing that. Don't do that.
And so James Harden actually started that series, and he was sent to the bench because he did not have a defined role, and he didn't actually get a lot of playing time in that series either. Mm. He's never learned how to play with 2 other. So when James Harden does not have the ball in his hand most of the time, he's not that effective. You saw when he was in Houston, he was an MVP. He was an MVP for a reason. He was able to control the ball. When he's playing with a Kevin Durant, he knows that he's in a submissive role. And you're playing with an elite ball handler, as some say, with Kyrie Irving. He know he can't keep the ball.
Did you say some say? Stop talking about sports. Hey, Tim, get the camera out. Take the camera off.
And so,
dismute this shit.
Get the.
You say what?
As some say.
Who's a better ball handler in Houston than Kyrie Irving? Who can handle the ball better than Kyrie Irving?
Let's not rabbit hole.
I ain't going to get rabbit hole. You a bugging since you walked in the door with that.
I like Steph Curry.
You're bugging. Who hit the shot on Steph Curry?
Stop it. Rabbit hole.
A shot. How many championships did he get against Steph Curry?
I'm not going down this rabbit
hole.
How many
championships did he get against Steph?
He got one.
Beast, man. You can't. Not Steph on his ball.
I'm not going.
Moving on.
Kyrie Irving is a great player, but I think that's because I think James Harden he struggles to define himself or define his role sometimes, and I think he's actually going to be better for Philly than what he was for New Jersey. Brooklyn.
Do we not just in professional sports, but in life? Do we undercut people because we covered the result? Because effectively, Charles Barkley, Karl Malone, John Stockton, Sean Kemp, Gary Payton got one. Those guys were phenomenal.
Absolutely.
But it feels like their career, and this happens in society, was defined by the result.
It is.
And
well, that's definitely, you know, our culture in general, and then it's sports specifically. You know, sports, we're in it for the end result, the win.
Absolutely.
Right? The stats, secondly. But then that also transfers over to society and our culture of advancing, moving forward, progressing, however you want to look. So the end result is important in everything we do. It's just the level of insensitivity.
That's what I'm trying to get to. Yes. The minimizing of the effort.
That has come along because, you know, we're all over a certain age and we can look back and say, okay, our teacher said, hey, good book report, but you missed the period. You know, you didn't put the comma right. You missed the capitalization. Mm-hmm. You didn't cry. You didn't fall apart.
Absolutely, yeah.
You supposedly grew and got better.
Absolutely.
To a point where at the end of the grade, you went to the next grade.
Yeah.
The result. So what's happening now is that people are so nasty.
There you go.
And then also, the recipient of that nastiness is so sensitive.
Yeah.
That's
so now when we look at a Ben Simmons scenario,
okay.
Because Ben Simmons ain't, you know, I think we could argue that when his shooting slump started, it was a slump. But then you have so many outlets of opinions that it started really, really mess with it and became a mental thing. Mm. There's such thing as a writer's block.
Absolutely. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know,
absolutely.
And there's certain things that I said, man, I'm just missing the answer right now. I got to take a walk. You know, I got to get off of this task because I don't have the answer right now. So that happens to all of us in all of our lines of work. But it comes down to how are people handling this, you know, how people are handling the criticism, you know, and not everyone is built to handle this. And then you got to understand, too, people are so nasty. I can't emphasize that enough.
Disrespectful.
Yeah. I mean, because it's one thing, and a lot of times people are saying things, you know, social media, Twitter, however, that they absolutely would not say in your face.
Right. No question.
That they absolutely would not say. In fact, if you see Ben Simmons walking by, that same Phillies fan is probably going to say, can I have an autograph?
Yep. Can I get a pic? Can I get a pic?
We do a selfie. Yeah.
And the commentators, too.
On Twitter, you know, your mama, your dad. So I think when you use a Ben Simmons as an example, you know, the age group he came through, early 20s, he has a sensitivity that people a little older, a little more mature, wouldn't cave to.
But sensitivity good, comes dude. From overexposure.
Yeah. And I was going to say, to D's point, that's also a choice. Because you know what LeBron James does when the playoff starts? He's off social media. And so sometimes you've got to limit the exposure. He doesn't watch ESPN because he knows.
Because LeBron lived without it before. Yeah. But see, you got to think about Ben Simmons. They haven't, these kids have not lived without social media.
So you really think it's because of
that's why I said sensitivity breeds, overexposure breeds sensitivity. Mm-hmm. Think about it. It does. Like he sees so much and he has no choice because it's the generation he's in. The generation that people was in the 70s, they did hippie stuff. The 80s did certain stuff. The 90s did certain stuff. Y'all, the 2000s, whatever generation you came from, you guys were just in the thick of things. And you just dealt with things after they come. You couldn't get away from it. You can't, like, at 20-something, you can't get away from social media. Because your mind don't know. Your Anything mind's else. Never conceived it not being
I got
here.
You. I get what you're saying. Mm. Okay.
And I think it's the pressure, man. And what we, and just talking about pressure, man, like, I was watching on Showtime, and everybody's pretty familiar with the Bill Cosby story. And I kind of want to set a foundation here. And I was watching it from a different perspective. I was watching it from a man's duality, his good and his evil. And I just wanted to, and I was watching the documentary, and I was like, man, they're about to crucify this dude. But they actually didn't when I was watching the documentary. I would recommend everybody go watch it. It's a riveting documentary. But I was watching Bill Cosby and how he started and what he meant to not just Black America, but America. I had no idea in the 60s and the 70s, all the educational shows he had, like early times. I knew about the Fat Albert. I knew about the other, you know, Cosby Show. I seen him on. I didn't know he was that big with PBS.
Yeah, yeah.
He was like our version of Bill Nye the Science Guy.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And watching all of that, like he was like, before he got into, you know, he was kind of pandering when he first started. But once he realized what was going on, Bill Cosby became one of the most woke individuals that you would ever see.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And I didn't even know that show existed. But watching all the good he did, what he did for Black colleges, what he did for HBCUs and education. But then the other side of it, the Quaaludes, the slipping stuff in people drink, the personal accounts people had of Bill Cosby, not just women but men, just watching how he was a totally different man. And tonight, keep in mind, these are two extremes, you know. And I wanted to use an extreme example, Keegan, because I'm watching this man do all of this good, but yet he could in the same day or same time frame do that much evil. And I wonder, how do we define our humanity through that, Keegan? Because do I throw away all those decades of good he did for all the tyranny? How do I measure that? I guess the question I'm asking to the group is, how do we properly measure his humanity based on those two spectrums? What is our central point? How do we ultimately not judge him, but measure the decisions that he made, and where should he stand with us? Not just him, but anybody in society. He's just we just using him as an example.
He's human.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, come
facts.
On.
I mean, at the end of the day, every person has just as much good as them in them as they do bad. One of my favorite lines that I heard, and I've recognized as within all of us, I used to always tell everyone, the brighter the picture, the darker the negative.
Come on. Come on.
So when you say that, you got to think about it. Just as good as I am or can be, I can be just as dark.
Right.
That resides in every person from the time they come out of their mother's womb. There was another saying that I once heard, and it was, in your lifetime, you'll always have two bears in your life. There's a good bear and there's a bad bear. Which is the winner? Which is the stronger of the two? And it's always going to be the one you feed.
That's good.
If you feed the good side of you, it will always overpower the dark side of you. And that's how you will always begin to make your decisions when you come face to face with a decision that needs to be made that could end up either good or bad.
Is evil necessary?
It's not that it's necessary, but it exists.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I emphasize.
How can you measure your good without your evil? I'm asking.
Mm.
I don't know that's something that you can do. When Jesus completed his 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness, he was confronted by Satan. You know, Satan translates in Greek to the accuser.
Okay.
40 days, 40 nights. So I've never gone 40 days and 40 nights without eating. So let's put me in the 12 hours without eating. I imagine I would probably be in the same, a comparable frame of mind, probably far more desperate Jesus was. There was not a character in a red jumpsuit and a tail and a pitchfork saying,
absolutely,
turn this stone into bread, throw yourself down this mountain, I'll give you all this. Mm-hmm. That was a spiritual company.
Yeah. Come on.
That joined Jesus. So that means that evil is ever present.
Ever present.
That's great. Sir. Come on, Paul.
It's absolutely ever present. And so that becomes, whether it's Bill Cosby, Daryl Hines, or anyone else, that becomes something that we as a human being are entirely consistently in conflict with.
Absolutely.
So how do you get to a point where you say, okay, well, how am I better? Talk about Paul. What a wretched man I am.
Come on.
What a wretched man, and because when I try to do good, evil is right
there.
He's
always present.
Mm-hmm. He's always present when I'm trying to do, and I can't shake it. Now, we're talking about Paul, that was a hell raiser when he was Saul.
Yes.
Had his conversion, becomes Paul.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Persecuted Christians.
And now he stoned people of the way. It wasn't Christianity at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The way. Stoned them, watched them, him right there, get him. Mm-hmm. And then got to a point where, hey, wait a minute. And they would look at him and say, wait a minute. Ain't that the one that was chasing us? No, I'm here on y'all side now. But even still, many, many books in the Bible that Paul is given credit for, he still had conflict. So it's not that it's necessary, it just exists, and it becomes your personal journey on how you contain it.
Right.
Because you're not going to do away with it, but how you contain it. And that becomes a temptation that everybody, and I think that's why the 40 days and 40 nights of temptation of Jesus was such a prominent story, because it goes to show you that even a son of man,
come on,
had to deal with it. And that's how he dealt with it. And I think preachers fail the congregation when they don't look at it. And, you know, we don't talk about it and give the parable of it, but we don't want to talk about it and say, wait a minute, that wasn't this icon that we like to give. We like to do symbols and icons.
That's
and
good.
Say, oh, it was the devil. No, it was a spiritual accompaniment. Something came in his most desperate, weakest state, which is when we have to be most careful.
Mm-hmm. Come on. Mm-hmm. Come on, D.
When wifey ain't.
That's good.
When wifey ain't.
That's good.
Acting right. You know.
Yeah. But that's good.
But at the traffic light, we got a little youngin' that looked our way. You know, mm-hmm. Or we got a like on our post.
Mm-hmm. Come on. Come on.
But wifey, yeah. You know, you come home, the robe, and, you know, they, oh, God, letting yourself go. That ain't what I'm married. No, we have that in our weakest moments. When the money ain't right, when... That is when the devil gonna show up and say, hey, Travis.
That's good. He fills in the gaps, me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
like those gaps when you weak, yeah. Like that's when you're supposed to, you let God make you strong. So you're gonna choose faith or fear.
Right.
One of the two. How do we do that, me? How do we allow God in those gaps? Because that's when the war starts, correct, D? Keegan? That's when the war starts. When your flesh is weakened.
Mm-hmm.
When that's when you're most vulnerable.
Right. Well, that's one of the things that we have to really focus on when we talk about this, because the battle between good and evil is always there. I believe I agree with D when he said that evil is always existed. And so it's just the point of how do we resist it. That's what the word says, resist the devil
that's
and he
good.
Will flee. And so that's one of the things that we have to understand. Like, we don't have to be overcome with evil. Revelation tells us, he who overcomes, you know. And so that's one of the things that we have to understand, that evil is going to be there. It's going to be a conflict that we have to face. But we can resist it and not have it become us. Right. or we become it.
Ivan, what is evil? Like, what is, like, define, is it always, Keegan, can you answer this too as well? What is it always defined? Is it built in with motive? How do you define evil? What would we consider evil?
In order for you to be able to define evil, you have to be able to define good. And honestly, personally, I believe that they both exist because it creates the balance. If God is all things,
then God is all things.
He's all things. And if I created man in my image and after my likeness, how wouldn't we be those all things? And so I believe that it's actually the balance. Does it have to exist? Is it a necessary? I personally believe it's a necessary.
What is it here for?
And to define it, I don't know that you can define one without defining the other.
It's here to define light and dark. You know, the separation. That's what it's here for. You know, that's what it says in Genesis, you know, during the creation that, you know, he created the light and he created the darkness for the night. And so that separation had to be there, you know, but the defining of it when we come under those powers is really up to us whether or not that happens. And so we have to stand in the light, not stand in darkness.
And that's why I say that I believe it's balanced. Because where there's day, there's always night.
Mm-hmm.
So the two, as he stated, the two are always going to be present. I don't think you can get rid of one and keep the other and have the other and get rid of the other. They're an absolute balance.
So what you have to take in consideration, what's behind evil is selfishness.
Yeah. Come on, that's what I was. Right. I want to dig there.
So what's behind evil is selfishness. Come on. What's behind good is
selfless. Right? Yeah.
Gotcha. And so whenever we consider someone as not being nice, not being good, or with the exception of there absolutely being a mental issue there, you know, you have people that are, I didn't get the attention I wanted, I didn't get or deserved, you know, so I'm going to behave a certain way.
Come on.
I'm going to talk to you a certain way. You know, so you have these things that are behind the evil that caters to my selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things we got to keep in mind is we are living in the age after Adam and Eve, when God was created and we were created in God's image. We were created in that was before Adam and Eve and the biting of the knowledge of the fruit of knowledge of good and evil. Right. So we gain that knowledge of good and evil through that act. What he had intended for us was before Adam and Eve, right? Mm-hmm. So we were never intended to know what evil ever was.
I don't agree with that. I don't agree with that. I think God is on purpose.
Absolutely.
What I mean that God is literally on purpose. So nothing's an accident. It was in the garden for a reason. Mm-hmm. I believe that God was going to teach us about that's why it was called the knowledge of good and evil.
The knowledge of good.
But what happened is, instead of being taught about the knowledge, we consumed it. And we became, and we started, anything you consume, you experience. Because it becomes a part of you. That's why people, when we eat, we literally eat for energy. Because what are we? We're energy. We're atoms. We're energy. So we consumed it and became it. And I think we were going to be taught those things. But the adversary told us something that we already were. You're going to be like God. Mm-hmm. Why do we need to be like something that we already were? That was the whole shame. So that's just my perspective.
But it's the same as it's the same as a child picking up a gun that has no knowledge of how to use the gun. They're going to hurt themselves.
No question.
That was the point. We weren't ready for it yet.
I agree. That's what I mean. I don't think we was mature. I don't think Adam and Eve had it's speculation, Ivan. This is semantics. But I just think as they grew, God would teach. But we want what we want when we want. Right. Yeah. Keegan, aren't we up? And we're impatient as a people. We want what we want.
And we've begun.
Keegan, when we want it.
Yes, sir.
When we want it. Yeah, we don't care who we hurt to get it. But I would say even before Eve and Adam, to Scott's point, Satan was the most beautiful angel there come was. On, and he was the leader on. Of the worship ministry. And what happened to Dee's point was he became selfish.
That's good.
Pride. He became prideful. Mm-hmm. He has to remember when he fell, he took a third of the angels with him. He did. Mm-hmm. That's 33%. Out of every 10 angels, he took three. So you have these people running, or these spirits running around, attaching themselves to individuals to do what Dee is talking about, which is what happened to Christ in the wilderness. It happens to us every single day, especially the strong believers who are out here making Satan mad when they get up in the morning, right?
That flow.
So
that flow.
I don't think evil is here to balance out good. I think evil is here for its own goals. Mm-hmm. And good comes from God. I think it all comes from God because he's creator of all things. But evil is here for its own goals. I always told Steve this. Satan don't care whether or not you believe in him. Mm-hmm. He just don't want you to believe in God. Mm-hmm. That's it. Has his own goals.
I think it's even a step further. I don't think he wants you to believe in you. Because if you can believe in you, if you can believe in you, you always will be able to defeat him because you were created in the image as he was.
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
I think he would rather you believe in you because if you believe in you, he recognizes that you're not strong enough by yourself. You need.
Or you think you are.
Yeah.
And you become vulnerable.
And that's he'll feed into that selfishness. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you'll get to a point to where you're so selfish that you won't reach for help when you
need. I think selfishness don't come from belief in self. I think insecurity, the lack of belief. I think, you know, that's when it's become selfishness. But fooling yourself, that's not individualism. You can't love somebody until you absolutely understand and love who you are.
Absolutely.
You have no chance. You will wreck every relationship. You will wreck everything in your life if you don't know who you are. That's why it's important to get to know you first. I think the lines can be blurred sometimes between it's all about me and you being. Sometimes you got to be selfish, Keegan, about your time because you have to give yourself time to grow and know who you are.
But I would never call investment selfishness.
Absolutely.
Right.
Not.
So when Christ went to pray in the Garden of Gethsemane, he took James and John. He took John and Peter with him and said, "Stay and watch. I'm gonna go pray by myself." He didn't bring them two with him.
Come on.
He went by himself because he had to invest. That was not selfishness on his part. He wasn't denying himself to Peter and John. He was going to pray. He was investing in himself. So I don't think investment in self is selfishness. I think when you start looking at the layers of it, you look at the seven deadly sins, you're thinking about gluttony and greed. Greed is you wanting more then you should have and taking it from somebody else.
Mm. Come on.
Gluttony is you want the money you have just for yourself.
Come on.
Right? But you're hurting other people. That's where the layers come into play. So I don't equate me investing in myself as selfishness. To your point, if I'm on E, I can't give Jog anything.
No.
Right.
I can't serve. I can't serve. I'm on E. But I want to bring it back to the original point about Bill Cosby. And I think when Scott said that he's human, that's a great point. Because humanity and divinity is two different things. Yeah. We're all human. So we all have those dark sides in us. The Indian proverb talks about it being two wolves, right? Mm-hmm. It's the one that you feed. But we all have that in us. If the question becomes, which way do you lean? And to Dee's point, when you're on E spiritually, when you're on E emotionally, that's when the devil and his minions steps in to make you lean into the bad side of yourself. Oh, you're not making no money. Go get more and do it this way.
Mm-hmm. And right? It has a whole lot to do with who you affect.
True. No question. In that process. No
good,
question.
Good and evil really doesn't have it so much to do with you, but who you affect. In that's a positive good. Or negative
I like
way.
That.
Yeah.
By what you do.
No
the
doubt.
Collateral damage.
The collateral damage.
Because either way, you're affecting people. If you don't take care of yourself, you're affecting your family. You're not going to be here for a long
time.
No
doubt.
If you're emotionally drained, you're emotionally on E, that's not so much the problem as it is when you're emotional E, what you do to other people. Mm. Are you taking their emotional energy from them?
Mm.
Are you taking that emptiness that you have and are you spilling it out onto somebody else?
And to your point, when you're on E, whether it's spiritually, emotionally, yeah, physically, whatever it might be, mentally, when you're on E, there's a certain level of desperation that sets in so absolutely, I can feed self, right? The question becomes, what source do I go to get that
when
food?
When you get to that point.
Where do I get my manna from, right? Mm-hmm. And that will probably dictate what happens because now I'm not going to use God for my manna. I'm going to use something else in the world for that manna.
I'm going to steal your manna out of your house.
Exactly. Right. But I will give you one point about Bill Cosby to Dee's point about spiritual accompaniment. I don't know if you ever seen the movie The Adjustment Bureau.
Yes.
With Matt Damon.
I love that movie. That's a good movie.
Check it out because it shows you how there are angels that are trying to help you stay on the path that God has already ordered steps for, right? Mm. And that brings me up because it's a very important book I want to check out too. It's a book that coincides with it called The Screwtape Letters.
Yeah.
Heard of the book called The Screwtape Letters? It's written by C.S. Lewis. It's an old school book, but it's the opposite of that movie. Screwtape is the nephew of Satan. And he's one of those particular minions that are assigned to people to talk to your ear, whisper to your spirit that, hey, do this thing to pull you away from God. And they are everywhere. Make no bones about it. If you believe in God, you have to believe in the devil. And he is, to your point about evil, being as real as it gets. And he has minions out here trying to pull you in directions where when you're weak, or when you think you are powerful and can do whatever you want, it's like put Quaaludes in somebody's drink to have sex with them, you might lean into that because your flesh tells you that it's Bill Cosby. But that doesn't negate the minds that he's uplifted. That don't negate the hearts that he has empowered. That doesn't negate the young men and women like myself who watched The Cosby Show, who watched Different World, who watched, whose son, my son and my daughter watched Little Bill, right? It doesn't negate the positivity that he's put in the world as well. You can't throw the baby up the bathwater, as Taps said in the last podcast. Yeah. We can't forget those things. Now, what I would say is accountability is not the same as crucifixion.
Nope.
Yeah. That's good.
So when you do wrong, you have to be held accountable and justice must be done for the victims of your acts.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
So I would say accountability does not equate to crucifixion because when you do wrong, you have to pay a penance.
And that's tough.
Plain and simple.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Plain and simple.
That's tough.
And the bill comes due.
Yes, it always comes due.
It's going to come due at some point.
And that's a tough thing, you know, and that's the back to the original. How do we really... You know, how do we really put this in perspective, you know, with a figure like that, if it happened in our lives? Speaking of, you know, what we just talking about, you know, how do we reconcile? Let's go to a more a touchable example. When fathers are absent from the home, you know, how do we reconcile that? They're out of the home, but their life is not over, so they're doing something good over here. How do we measure that? How do we put that in perspective? But the question I got, D, is with absent fathers, black fathers, because there's been a stigma around our community, correct? Mm-hmm. You know?
Just and, that, and, a stigma.
Stigma.
Does not
for
make
a long
it
time, it's been a stigma. And it's been said. It's been talked about. It's been perpetuated. It's been a narrative.
Right.
To some degree, to some people, it's been an expectation. Almost like if you do take care of your kids, wow, that's special.
Right.
Yeah.
And
he's a good guy because he takes care
of
your kids.
And some of us, we fed into that. Some of us guys who do stay, we feed into that. Like it's, oh, I'm doing something special.
Right.
You know, I can agree that I thought since I did that, because I'll say this, there's a difference between being a father, I said this before, and a parent.
Oh, no question.
Yes, absolutely.
Because a parent is active.
Right.
And I got to say, I did not understand how to be a parent at first.
Right. No.
I just didn't understand. I didn't understand, and shout out to all the women who take care of children, because that is a hard job.
Absolutely.
That is a, yeah. it's a,
from where I sit, it's like an impossible job, but they do it day in and day out. But I just thought, as a father, this is what I do. But once I start learning what a parent truly was, it's conceivable that every man with kids thought about, oh, I just want to leave. Come on. Every man then thought about it, and you, but you didn't pull the trigger. How could a man get to the point, D, to where he walks out? Because we're all men. We all have children. We all understand the pressures of fatherhood, right, in this day and age.
Well, the one, you know, we have this joke, probably, I must speak on our community, you know, kids don't come with, on, you know, manual instructions. you know, and we know that. And just like you said, you know, when I became a dad, what do I do? I know I felt that. I'm pretty sure that we've all had that.
Yes.
First one.
Yes.
One thing when it comes to black people, black men specifically, is that we have not excavated. We have not examined. We have not reconciled. And we have not atoned prior to becoming a parent slash father. And the reason why those four segments are important is because of where we came from in this country.
It's good.
Right? You can't say that slavery is 160 years ago from this point in time, and the fact that they let the gates up, and so everybody's shoe created new systems.
Right.
Yes, it is.
Created absolutely new systems to imprison us. We just can't call it slavery. We're going to call it prison. We're going to call it Jim Crow. We're going to call it the other things, and that have all the significant dysfunction that I do not believe existed in our mother.
Come on.
I do not believe that the culture of West Africa, Ivory Coast, Senegal,
Benin,
beat their children with switches. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that. I believe that was something we inherited.
I agree.
And so when you have the diaspora of slavery, 160 years go by, okay, now we finally have equal rights. We can go to college. We can get careers. We can own businesses out in public. You know, outside of Black Wall Street. You know, we can do our thing. We have not excavated. We have not dug in to say, okay, I'm Daryl Hines. I had my first child at 26. Who am I? What did I inherit from my absent father?
Come on.
From my teenage mother. From my stepfather that stepped in. What did I inherit? What did I inherit from their parents? Like, you got to dig that up. And that was something that I happened not to do until I went to Howard. And it was a personal assignment for me. It wasn't, you know, a school assignment. It was a personal assignment. So, you know, that family tree commercial you say,
yeah,
I'm going to try that. And I just started asking family members.
Ancestry.
Ancestors.com. Mm-hmm. And then the light bulb went off. My mother's mother died when she was 8 years old. My grandfather, my mother's father, was a functional alcoholic. Jim Crow, 50s and 60s. Paint that picture. An uneducated black man that didn't drive, that had five children, widow. That no one, in the context, no one took it in. You know, we like to think that everyone, every neighbor, aunt, uncle took the children in. In this case, that did not happen.
Wow.
So my mother actually did not get what she was supposed to have as an 8-year-old daughter, as a 13-year-old daughter, as a 16, 18-year-old daughter, so which means she went and fell to a predator God. Another 16-year-old impregnated, and that is where I came from. Yeah. So without me identifying that, the excavation part, here I am, 26, 27-year-old father. What am I going to do? But naturally, you know, my motto was do what wasn't done to me.
Yeah,
I'm going to be here.
Yep.
Yeah. Right. Oh, I ain't going nowhere. I'm going to be here.
We stopped at that.
But what?
A lot of us stopped at, I'm going to be here.
What do I do?
What does that mean? Yeah.
What do I do here? Yeah. Right. I ain't going. We got that established. But what do I do here?
Right.
And it wasn't until 6-7 years into being a parent that I went through that one process and I excavated. Then I had to examine it. The examination was,
that's good.
Oh, well, this is why I didn't get and the hugs and the, my boy can do anything.
Yeah.
My mother never got it.
Yep.
So it wasn't in her source.
So it's not something she could give.
Right. And so then I had to reconcile with that. Mm-hmm. Okay. I had to forgive. And then I had to atone because I'm 7-8 years into me being a parent. Oh, I went about this the wrong way. Mm.
we suffer from generational PTSD, which is the truth. When you dig up, when you did that excavation, what you recognize is your PTSD, where it came from.
Where it came from, yeah.
PTSD is post-traumatic stress, right? It's a disorder. What we know about PTSD is that it's chemical.
Come on.
Right? It changes the chemical balance in your bloodstream. And anything that can affect your bloodstream is something that you can pass to your offspring.
That's good. That's good.
Now imagine 400 years of PTSD being passed through your bloodstream to your offspring. This is why I say when we relate a lot of things to slavery, that it's not being a victim. It's fact. It's truth. It's real. It happened. Now, victimhood is saying that, you know, because these things happen to me, I can't do X, Y, and Z. Right. That's not what I'm saying.
Right.
What I'm saying is we have to first recognize the trauma took place, recognize that it changed our course, and make a decision to course correct.
That's good.
Now, being able to course correct, first you have to know what trajectory you're already on before you make the decision to course correct.
And I'll say this, Keegan, ambition cannot drive you out of your trauma.
It can.
No.
Smoke screen.
It just puts a blanket over it.
It does. And it allows your trauma to build more narratives.
Mm-hmm.
It's allowed you to think more things about yourself. It allows you to dive deeper into the hole because you got to the achievement and you realized that wasn't the answer you was looking for.
Yeah. They didn't call it post-traumatic paper cut. It's trauma. Trauma,
that's good.
Trauma is something that will kill you.
It
if
will.
It's not,
absolutely.
If it's not taken care of properly.
And I was, look at how they deal with soldiers.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But what it generates is the whole thing is post-traumatic stress.
Come on.
Stress is a spirit.
Stress is a spirit.
Come on, Keegan.
And that's what it actually builds in a people group, not just the individual.
Absolutely.
To your point, it's not post-traumatic paper cut. It's post-traumatic stress. And you can give stress away. You can give away a common cold. You can give that away.
You can.
You can give that away.
It's an energy
in your bloodstream to your children or in the energy I give you while I'm just being around you.
Absolutely.
I can give you bad energy.
Absolutely. Wow.
So it's not necessarily just passed through off stream. It could have possibly been passed off.
I'm gonna let you die like that.
He mad about Kyrie Irving. Yeah. Keep going.
You know, I didn't let you know. Go ahead.
Steph Curry got handles.
Me laughing at you.
Steph Curry got handles. But it's not only just passed through your offspring, but it can literally be something that's given to you from just a close neighboring person or a neighbor or a relative that's outside of, and so because of, and then when you think about it, what's in your community?
Mm-hmm.
And when you think about everybody had that exact same path of 160 years ago, and then going through 400 years of that, they're all bringing that forward. It's almost, how do you really completely get rid of it unless you excavate?
And I think that takes time too.
Yeah,
I think that takes time because,
you have to tear it down.
I think sometimes we focus too much on the generational curses when sometimes we have to focus on the generational blessings.
Yes,
absolutely.
Because when you allow blessings to come, you don't have to chase blessings. This whole thing, listen, if you're in the right position and you're doing the right things and you're true to yourself, blessings will come.
Absolutely.
They will come. It's not a complicated formula to blessings, but it's not easy. It's hard because you got to come within yourself. And as being a father, being a parent, like, you have literal lives in your hand. God has given you the responsibility to guide. You have knowledge, but knowledge without wisdom is an abuse of power.
Well, I would say receiving blessings is not difficult for anybody.
Come on.
Everybody wants a blessing. I think where people fail is not having good stewardship.
Yeah. That's good, Keegan.
And that's where,
talking to me now.
That's where a blessing can go south because you misuse or mishandle it, right? Or you think it's really for you. It could be for somebody else. You're just a vessel. So I think receiving a blessing is not the issue, because at one time or another, everyone got fruit in their life.
Come on.
The question is, were you a good steward of it?
Over the fruit. Come on.
That's the only question you got to ask yourself. That's when you look in the mirror. To Dee's point about atonement, reconciliation, as Fortune Dee said, reconciliation and atonement is the two most difficult things. See, excavation, examining, that's about act. But reconciliation is about, hey, I got to forgive somebody.
That's good.
Yep. That's good.
People struggle with that. Yeah. I got to forgive someone.
Forgiving.
Especially when think you've been done wrong. I got to forgive someone. And then atonement, now that's self-assessment. Yeah. And most folks looking in that mirror, they'll look at the window and blame somebody else, but they ain't looking in that mirror.
That's hard.
That's two difficult things of that.
Yeah. And just to your point, you have to forgive somebody, but atonement is now you got to forgive yourself.
Yes, exactly.
And that's the most difficult part. Because now it's like, man, you got to look at yourself and be like, I didn't do it right. And I can't put that on somebody else, because in order for me to put that on somebody else, that means I never forgave them.
And that's when the devil shows up.
Exactly.
See, the devil exactly when he comes up. Those two sides.
Yep.
Up, those last two points, mm-hmm. when it comes to the self-reflection.
Yep.
And self-examination, then becomes rationalization, anger,
justification,
resentment.
Yep.
Justification, all these different things that could make it easier and simpler.
Yeah. And when you say the devil, you mean that spiritual thing that Christ had on him.
Yeah.
Not a character. Let us be clear. We're not talking about a character. See, you're responsible for, you create your own devil. Mm-hmm. You create your devil in your life.
But I was,
it's always going to be you.
I don't want to create a caricature. I don't want to make it like comical.
That's what I mean.
But
yeah.
let's be clear.
These
malevolent spirits exist.
Yes. There you go.
They exist. And they are here for the sole purpose of ruining you. They will give you something today you love, knowing that in the future, 10 steps downstream, it's going to ruin you.
You know, they're here for that. Kaiser Soze, and I'm going to go to you in a second, mate. And the Unusual Suspect said, the greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing you that he didn't exist. Because we made him a character. Mm-hmm. And people aren't afraid of characters. You know why they're not afraid of characters? Because they know it's play. It's an acting.
It's not real.
Look how many movies
and
commercials you see.
It's not real.
It's not haunting or daunting.
It's a TV show.
Nobody in America is afraid of a scary movie anymore.
Yeah.
No. The nostalgia is gone.
Yeah. They watched a series called Lucifer.
Yeah, true. I'm going to make a point about that, but I want you to go to Meek real quick. I got to make a point about that.
Go ahead, because I'm going to ask Meek the question about the role of a father. Oh, so go ahead.
So I like to compare certain things to movies, because I think art imitates life sometimes, and then life imitates art sometimes. But the movie The Fallen,
come on.
Denzel Washington, John Goodman. Yep. When I think about how that spirit, Beelzebub, was moving through people, I think about when Christ moved the evil spirit who called themselves Legion, and there was many of them, out of the crazy man into the pigs. Trust me when I say, because I believe in the Bible, trust me when I say malevolent spirits are here. And if you're not putting on the armor of God every single day, when you walk out your door, you are at the mercy of the streets, of this world. And trust me when I say, the Bible tells me is, the prince of darkness is operating here.
Absolutely. Plain and simple. It'd be operating in me sometimes. I'll be honest. but you got to recognize that, you know, you got to know where you are. Mm-hmm. It's difficult. After we do the work, you know, when you go to any job, D and me, you got to know your role and responsibilities. It's important to understand the mechanics of what you're doing. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you, what is the role of a father?
I believe the role of a father is to be a protector, a provider, an example, role of a father has many aspects that, you know, the rest of the family depends upon to hold them together. So I believe the role of a father is not just one particular thing. It's various things that father becomes. He embraces, like we were talking about earlier. You know, I was a parent. There's a difference between a parent and a father, and so the role of a father has that hat as well to wear. So, it's that's what I believe it is. Yeah. That's the role of a father.
Yeah. And I agree with everything you said. I want to expand on one word in particular, and that's protector. Mm. Because typically in our society, in our culture, we're thinking protector, typically ADT, Smith & Wesson.
Yeah. Right? Absolutely.
But I had to learn that it was essential to protect your child's spirit.
Yes.
That's good. Mm.
That's good.
Yes.
You have to, that little twinkle in their eye that they start to develop.
Yeah. Man, like, that's good.
Months, mm-hmm. You know, when they start to, you know, get around, they look at you a certain way. We weren't nurtured because of some of our background. I'm not going to put everybody, you know, lump everyone together. Because of some of our PTSD, our experiences, we didn't recognize that. Mm-hmm. And so we took the literal meaning of protector and said, okay, let's make sure the door locked, alarm is set, got car insurance. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. The practical side of it. But we did not make sure that we protected our children's spirit.
Yeah,
I agree.
So when I hear...
When I look at my kids now, 28 and soon to be 25, I can see where that light flickered on my watch.
Mm. When I see father now, I see king. And here's the reason why I say that. A king's job is to protect his kingdom. Mm-hmm. A king's job is to be the servant of those that follow him. A king's job is that of a servant. Yeah. Jesus was a king here, right? But the message that he gave to the disciples was that he was here to serve them, not for them to serve him. Mm-hmm. Think about it. He washed their feet. They didn't wash his. Mm-hmm. When you think about a kingdom, the job or the role of the king is to make sure that the kingdom thrives and doesn't perish. Not himself. The kingdom. When there's a problem out in the land, they bring it to the king's court. When we have a problem, whose court do we take it to?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And we were always supposed to model that. We were always meant to model that. Mm-hmm. We were always meant to be kings in that sense.
I want to expand on one of the words that Meek said, too, about the father. And that's provider. And in our social society, what that means is income. And it could not be so further from the truth, because that's only one aspect of providing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The role of a provider is somebody that's going to provide love, somebody that's going to come and provide peace, mm-hmm. somebody that is going to listen to you. There's so many other roles of provider than just your financial means. And sometimes in our society, what we've seen is, hey, if I'm bringing in mid six figures, everything I say goes because I'm providing. Mm-hmm. But you haven't given anything and shared yourself in love.
Right.
You have not actually shown concern or understanding, and those are things that fall under the umbrella of being a provider.
And that's emotional that's intelligence. And that again, that comes from the trauma we suffered. We're taught to be hard. Yeah. America inherently, we're going to talk about this in another podcast, they're violent. We're in a violent society. That's why we lead with fear. Do as I say. Do this. Reacting versus responding. It was tough for me because your children require vulnerability as a man.
Right.
They require you to be vulnerable and to be yourself and not be in the, it's okay to be, like I have girls. So it's, oh, I'm masculine, but I have to understand and respect their feminine nature. And I have to, I'm not trying to be feminine, but I have to make sure that I'm able to communicate my emotions effectively to them without making them feel any type of way.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes men and fathers, we're taught, like you just said, we take the literal translation and the spiritual translation, Keegan, of being a provider, a protector, being an emotional foundation for our children too as well. Because especially if you have girls or boys, it doesn't matter when they get into relationships. You know what your what they seen your mother and father do, whether they're together or not together, they see how you treat each other, and that pretty much set the pathway for how absolutely. A girl going to allow somebody to absolutely. Treat her, and it sets the pathway for the little man on how he's going to treat a woman.
Absolutely.
You know, how do we, Keegan, help each other with the tides of fatherhood, with the ever-changing nature of fatherhood? How do we help each other with that? Because I think fathers, man, we live in caves sometimes. You know, we go in our cave and we sit there. And sometimes that's the only way we can find peace. But the very cave we stay in, we get locked into.
So one word I'll use, we typically use this word as a noun, but I'm gonna say we should use it as a verb.
Come on.
And that's humility.
Come on.
And what I mean by that is talk about how do we help each other. Being humble enough to say, you know what? Hey D, I'm struggling with something as a father. Come on. Can you help me? Can you give me some wisdom? And approach D or Ivan or Steve or Scott or me or anybody who have children in a way that I can receive what you want to tell me. So I will start there. That's one. And two, humbleness will tell you that as a father, I'm not a mother. So you got to understand that you do have limitations based on what your child might need.
Yeah.
So if you have the mother in the mix, whether you're married to that person, whether they're still in the life, because you're separated, or because you are not even married, you just boyfriend and girlfriend, whatever it might be, making sure that you give room for that parenting tool to be utilized for your children.
That's good.
Because a lot of times we would talk about the father as if it is the end all be all. We talk about motherhood like it's the end all be all. And the reality is God created a union for a particular reason.
Yeah, the balance.
And when you look at what Paul wrote in Ephesians 5 about the process of the Christian family, you know, what husbands should do, what wives should do. He also said what children, what you should do for your children. And one of the commandments says, honor your mother and your father. But the first thing that Paul wrote in Ephesians 5 was submit to one another. So I would say, let's first start with humbleness so we know that, hey, I ain't got all the answers. Meek, I got an issue with my son. Can I talk to you about it? And being willing to receive that wisdom.
Come on.
Yeah. Approaching his throne.
That's good.
With a submissive perspective so yes. I can receive something. Because I ain't got all the answers. And I was a young father. And I'm talking about 20 when my daughter came here. And I ain't know what the hell to do.
And I'm
messing the shit up. I'm just going to be real. I'm messing stuff up, you know, on that path. But being humble, I think, is a big part of that.
And I think the blueprint to parenting is you got to start with empathy. I think that you start there because every experience that you have, D, is totally different than mine.
Yep.
Because our kids are different.
Right.
Yep. They're not the same. And we feel inadequate sometimes because we feel like we're dealing with, I'm the only person dealing with this. Mm-hmm. There can't be nobody in the world dealing with this. Mm-hmm. Listen, loneliness is a place where the devil resides.
Yes.
That is a place where the devil, if you're confused about anything, I promise you that's not God.
Yeah, he doesn't live anywhere.
It's the place of loneliness and confusion, and we allow ourselves the responsibility of it. May not be your fault that you are on the trail of loneliness, but it's your responsibility to get out of it.
Yeah.
Your life is your responsibility.
Yeah.
And I think fathers sometimes, we've been beat down. Yeah, we've been stereotyped. And to the father, let me say this about black fathers. Just, you know, black fathers. Guilt is a hard thing to get over, D.
Yeah.
It is a And for the fathers, let me say out there who's not been present in their kids' life, don't allow guilt to stop you.
Absolutely not.
You can come back. We don't. We always talking about, you know, and we're giving kudos to the to ones that's there, but we need the ones that's not there to get back in their children's life.
Yes.
Because they you can be you. Restored. Everybody can be restored. Mm. We just got to make the, before we leave, D, we got to make the decision. And I think sometimes we have to start digging in the weeds and find the people, the undesirables to our society, right. And bring them back to life. That's the whole point of the deep surface. It's easy to praise somebody when they and shining and they're doing what we think is right. But you go find somebody who really it's needs not. Your help.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Who really are a couple of seconds away.
Your light is more effective in dark.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's the whole purpose of this, D, before we close out. That's the whole purpose.
No, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, when we kind of map out the lineage, the linear or maybe even abstract way that we've gotten here, you know, it's imperative that we each, and that's been my attitude about when we have these marches, when we have these collective efforts, you know, when something goes wrong in society, I say, you know, the reason why it dies out is because we're going about it the wrong way. In the 60s, leading up into the 60s, I should say, you could trust that your household was comparable and compatible to mine. And same to the left. So together we linked arms, mm-hmm. And we were a
that's
force.
Good. That's good. That's good. That's
community.
Good. That's good.
We were a force.
Come on.
But today we're so fragmented because the first thing we did when we got some money, we went.
Come on.
Come on.
Yeah, you in there. You in there.
That's another.
That's good. That's another podcast. Another
topic. Level, yeah. So we that's became more fragmented. We left our unions. Mm-hmm. And then from that point on, thought we were really doing something. And really what we started doing was weakening our community.
Breaking the puzzle. Breaking it into
you know,
a puzzle.
So to get to a point where, you know, we can now, and now for me to go and reach the brother in need, I got to use GPS and get all the way over there when he really used to be upstairs, next door, across the street, the house behind me.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And then he can lend himself to observation and being, you know, taking a look and saying, okay, wow, I see how Brother Jones and Deacon Thomas are doing it.
My brother's keeper.
And I'm going
to
get it going.
And you know what else they had back then, D, to your word earlier, so they had vulnerability. It let you in. Yeah. Today, I'm not going to tell Ivan what my credit score is.
Come on.
It's 450. I don't want him to know that. Even though he can help me.
Come on. Oh, come on, Keegan.
Even though he can help
come
me.
Come on, Keegan.
Even though he can that's help good. Me, I don't want him to know that. They had vulnerability back then. They knew the problems and how so they could, hey, let me help Brother John out. Let me help Sister Stephen out because I can help. They need help, and they let you in. Today's
call me Sister Steve.
I did. I did.
You see, I did win. I did. Full nigga.
Yeah. Look, but guess
D,
what?
Lift D in here.
I like Kyrie Irving.
But man, just wrapping up, man. Like you
he's
know,
decent.
Can I add something real quick?
Oh no, go ahead, go ahead, go ahead, okay. Go ahead.
Well, what I wanted to say as well, another role of the father. I believe would be to cultivate.
That's good.
To,
that's good.
To help his belongings or his garden actually grow.
That's great.
And then it's not just that growth, like we were talking about the earlier. It's not just that growth that he's responsible for his children or his wife, but it's also growing pains that he has to go through within himself. And so as he goes through that, it is a learning curve. It's a learning process that he has to go to. Like for me, you know, we talk about, you know, being young, having you know, children and whatnot. I was 16 when I had my first child.
Yep, I remember that.
I found out when I was 15, had him at 16. And so I had to grow up really fast. But at the same time, on the flip side of that, the balance, I didn't know how to do that. Right. And so it took a while to get there. And now, you know, as I went through that time frame, I can see my kids now saying to my youngest daughter, like, you didn't handle things that way like you do now. Mm-hmm. Because I had to learn. I had to grow. And so not only did I learn
that's
and grow,
that's good.
And the father learn and grow,
the tree is growing while the sap is growing.
It's also the kids seeing that, you know, that example, that resemblance happening, you know, for them as well. They see something going on with them. And so that's the whole aspect that we have to also understand, that the role of the father is also to cultivate everything that, that he's responsible for, I would say, you know, in the role of a father. But like we say, it's not just the father that we look at in that aspect, it's the mother as well. But when they work together in unison, then, you know, the garden grows. Mm-hmm. And so I just want to put that in there, you know, the role of the father is to, you know, grow.
He's a gardener. He's a gardener.
It is. And it's legacy too, man. And just, it's tough being a father. It's tough. It's tough. It's not easy. I can tell you from personal experience, I have experienced trials and tribulations because of the trauma that I was able to ignore my trauma. Because once I got kids, I seen a reflection of myself. And it started forcing me to deal with, if I don't fix this, if I'm not able to make them whole by my example, then they're going to go out and make their own decision. If I don't give them a proper, that's what I'm accountable for.
Yeah.
Can I say something to that?
Go ahead.
What you're talking about is being humble. The Bible says that you should die daily.
Mm. Come on.
Die to your flesh.
You need to die to your flesh. Mm. And dying to your flesh means that putting myself on the back burner for someone else, for someone else's benefit other than my own. Any effective father is always going to put themselves last. Now, one of the things I have we say that all the time. We say this all the time in my church. It's like a running joke between me and my pastor. I say, he always says, "Did you die today?" And it's funny because it reminds me of, you know, The Hangover when Chai was like, "But did you die?" "But did you die?"
I think sometimes I don't think we have to put ourselves last.
It's not necessarily putting yourself last. But we do that though. But it's really more about putting the things in front of you that are more important than my own self.
But I think it creates a gap. Even that language, putting, I think two firsts can exist. But I think that we are just as important. And I think we don't see our value sometimes because our value is not properly shown out in the public. But I get what you're saying, and I want to serve.
Yeah, I'll give you a different perspective on that one note, because when I go back to what was written in Ephesians 5 by Paul.
I'm coming, John.
When he says, submit to one another. When Scott says, I'm putting myself last, it's because you're the wife or the friend will put you first.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
that's
what
good.
Happens
okay.
is
mutual. That's
yeah,
good.
See,
it's a mutual
see, yeah,
displacement.
Exactly. It's a yin and the yang because that's why you have partnership.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to give myself up for the benefit of the family, and then
they're
you
do it the same.
Will take care of my needs, and then vice versa.
In a perfect world.
Let me just say that.
It's idealistic.
Dude,
it's idealistic.
Talking about God, I just cussed. My bad.
Yeah. When you think about that dichotomy, that dynamic, if I'm putting you first, the reason that I don't put you first is because I don't believe that you will. Now, that's a trust issue.
Yes.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. If I'm that's putting good. Myself good. First and I'm
John,
putting
that was
myself
worth the 5 minutes.
Before
I'm sorry.
You,
yep.
It's because I don't think that you're going to put me first when I put you first.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's where you become selfish.
Mm-hmm.
That's where selfishness stems
that's,
from.
That's
good.
Good,
Scott.
That's good.
Scott, you got 50 tonight. I'm gonna keep it a buck, Scott. You've been talking.
We're 13
you got 50.
Boys.
You, hey,
we're
listen.
Boys.
You and D low key was going back story for story. I'm gonna be honest with you. I was like, damn, D, that's captivating, man. I'm going, Scott. Y'all, listen, I'm gonna be honest with you.
Y'all, some, but listen, man. Wrapping up. Anybody got any closing remarks, man? Because this has been good. Because I want to really on this version in this week of the podcast. I really want to. Sometimes on the other one, guys, who's watching. We talk about, we brought topics, but I want to kind of bring it down to topics like this that we can talk about our experiences, because this is important, man.
Yeah.
You know, you literally, like I said earlier, your children's life is on the line based on the example you create or the lack of example you create. Mm-hmm. D, I thank you for coming, my guy.
Thanks.
When we're able to get you out. It's rare to be able to get you out, man. Black business. Go ahead and talk about your business for a second, man, while we got you here.
Hey, Velocity Denim, 3 Charlotte locations, Concord Mills University, Charlotte Premium Outlets, and then we open in Charleston back in October. And
we're Greenfield.
Absolutely, absolutely.
By the end of third quarter this
year. Okay, that's awesome.
Listen, man. I'm gonna have to go. This has been a phenomenal conversation. Anybody got anything else before we go? Man, this has been good, man. Listen, everybody out there, please subscribe on YouTube. Please follow us on Instagram, the Deep Surface Pod on both. Man, listen, we appreciate everybody who tunes in, man. We will keep bringing you guys great content. And I want to thank all the guys up here for coming out, man. And we are out. That's a wrap.
Yes.